Welcome back, folks, and thank you once again so much for joining me. I have to tell you, these last few weeks, Wednesday nights have been a real sort of emotional apogee, getting to share great art in such an infectious environment. Usually when we use the word infectious, it's not a good thing. But when I think about the enthusiasm that something like music can generate, it sounds trite perhaps, but it really is palpable. And so having people to share that with, I think, really amplifies that effect that we all experience. So thank you again for joining me, and welcome to lecture number 4, which is subtitled The Twilight of Tonality. We're going to get into tonality and exactly what that means. And after the twilight of tonality comes the absence of tonality. And of course, some of you have heard the word atonality. Perhaps half of tonight's lecture is going to deal with the concept of atonality. And we're going to talk about, to paraphrase something that Aaron Copland said in the 1930s, how the composers chased all of the listeners out of the concert hall with the music that they were composing. So I want to especially thank folks for coming out tonight, because some people might see a lecture that's titled The Twilight of Tonality, and you might look at it, and I would understand if you had the impulse to sort of turn around and run the other way, because let's face it, the music that we're going to be talking about, especially at the end of today's program, not so much at the beginning, is music that many find to be difficult to digest, let's say. It's difficult to relate to some of the artistic concepts that are conveyed and embodied in that music. So we're going to get to that, and my hope is that at the end of tonight's program, we'll have a new and enhanced perspective on art during this amazing cusp of music history between, say, 1900 and the ensuing couple of decades, where music really changes fundamentally in some very radical ways. One of the questions I often ask my students is to analyze this word modernism. And I always ask them, if modernism started 115 years ago, let's say, musicians tend to market right around the year 1900, why do we call it modern if it's 100 years old or more? And of course, the word modern here denotes a radical change from that which precedes it. And I think that's going to be abundantly clear when we listen, especially to Arnold, Schoenberg, and to some degree as well, when we listen to Igor, Stravinsky. And those composers will be featured in the second half of tonight's program. In the first half, I tend to, ease you into it. So my objective tonight is to present you with music from the end of the 19th century by looking at two composers who are really straddling this, again, this historical cusp between the late Romantic period and the early modern period. So I think perhaps what we should do now is to pick up where we left off last week. And last week we left off talking about, you remember, that polarizing figure, Richard Wagner. And we talked about how Wagner's music tended to reflect some of the philosophical principles that Wagner was drinking deeply of, namely the philosophy of people like Schopenhauer, Nietzsche, to a lesser degree, philosophers also from the German tradition, such as Hegel, Feuerbach, and others in addition to them. Wagner's music, because it had this, again, you might say, a philosophical impulse, especially in works like Tristan und Isolde, or at the end of the Ring cycle, what we found last week, I think, is that the music got a little bit fuzzy, didn't it? It got a little bit murky. We talked about how Mozart is so crystal clear when he starts a piece of music. He tells you exactly what key we're in, right? And we know what to expect because we know that the music is sort of gravitationally bound by the notes that are in that piece. In other words, if I start adding notes from outside this key, this is C major, if I start using notes that are outside of C major, it weakens our sense of stability as listeners. And I think that's one thing that we can really attribute to Wagner, is this loosening, or maybe another word we could use is weakening of tonality. That Mozart, it's crystal clear, even when he's being fancy, right, he sort of tells you, okay, well, you hear some notes, but really the key is this, we're in F major, right, in this particular case. And he even starts in the left hand with that chord that tells us in no ambiguous way that the key of the piece is whatever it is. But what we said about Wagner last week was that Wagner introduces harmonies from the get-go, that is to say, right at the beginning of the prelude to Tristan, this massive opera. He gives us a chord. Which takes us as listeners into this, again, this fuzzy or murky, or perhaps we could say a musically opaque kind of place, where we're not sure. We know that Mozart is, you know, F major. But what is this? Actually, historians and musicologists have a name for this chord. You know what we call it? I heard someone say it. The Tristan chord. Because the more you try to analyze it, the more you realize that it doesn't conform to any of the normal harmonies that were utilized by composers for hundreds of years up to that point. It is its own entity. And trying to call it, well, it's a double appoggiatura chord, and there are people who do this, who will analyze music theorists and try to go through, but most people simply refer to it as the Tristan chord because it is so unique. And it really, I think, marks for us, because we've been doing this diachronic study of music history, it marks for us a turning point. Wagner, for better or for worse, love him or hate him, I think is responsible for steering music in a new direction towards a tonality. Because once you start introducing notes that don't behave the way the listener expects them to, then you're setting the listener up on a course where they're sort of not sure. And if you think about it, one of the things that drives us as listeners and gives us that sense of satisfaction is chord resolution and where melodies resolve the way that we expect them to. If I play something like this, this is something that might have figured in the Baroque period, let's say. We have to finish it, right? Have you ever wondered why is that we as listeners want to hear that resolution so badly? If I play a chord progression, something like this. Why is it that we have this sort of cathartic reaction when we hear those notes move in whatever direction I'm playing them? And by the way, it's not bound to key. I play with the D. I can play in C. It's the same idea, right? It binds us as a listener and it takes us on this journey. And it's that sense of resolution, it's that sense of direction, of sequential flow that is musically logical, whatever that means. I'm going to get into that in the second half of the program. That makes listening to music such an enjoyable and satisfying experience for most of us. So if you're ever wondering what is it about music that we like so much, to some degree, I think it's the fulfillment of expectation. That the music moves in a certain direction that we find, and this is in the Western world, goes back to before the Renaissance, that we tend to find as human beings, our species finds these chord progressions and this musical behavior of these notes, we find it satisfying. I had a student once who asked me, Professor, why do all pop songs follow the same chord progression? And of course, not all pop songs follow the same chord progression, but many of them do. And I countered with the question, I said, why is fast food salty? The answer is simple, because people like it. And I think to some degree, when Wagner opens up Pandora's box, so to speak, with Tristan, he sets music on a new course, not for everybody. Again, we're going to talk about this more within the next 15 minutes, but remember last week we said there was this sort of ideological battle that was waging in the 19th century between Wagner and the progressives, including his father-in-law Liszt, and of course the so-called conservatives like Brahms or Mendelssohn earlier in the century. So, one thing that you'll find sometimes in the literature is people will talk about Wagner as he's the guy who opens the door to the 20th century. Wagner died in 1883. He never lived to see the 20th century. But when we say he opens the door to the 20th century, what we mean is that his works, especially his late works, and Tristan in particular, I think, opened this door into a musical soundscape which for many listeners leaves you sort of floating with no direction of what to anticipate. We have another word we use to describe this kind of music. It comes from the Greek word meaning colorful. I think some of you probably know this word. We say the music is intensely chromatic. Chromatic, right? It's colorful, meaning it utilizes all these notes sometimes in no particular order, in no particular relationship, or no expected relationship. This is a heavy concept. We could spend many hours talking about tonality and all of its implications. Fortunately, we don't have many hours. If we did have many hours, I'd probably start tonight by playing the entirety of Mahler's Second Symphony. But we don't have that time, so instead I'm going to tell you a little bit about Mahler and how he, as a composer, as an artist, fits into this period. We're not going to listen to anything by Mahler tonight. Part of the reason we're not is because his works are of a staggering scope. He wrote 10 symphonies, and the Third Symphony is typically about 100 minutes in performance. If you think about a symphony that's an hour and 40 long, that's a pretty big symphony. That's a pretty ambitious thing to write, and it's pretty ambitious to expect an audience to be able to sit there and maintain their focus. Let's face it, it's not always the easiest thing to do, especially for a longer piece. Remember what Clara Schumann said about Tristan and Isolde when she was asked? She said, I never knew something so abhorrent could be composed. The word is exactly. She didn't like it. Another great commentary on this comes from the wife of English composer Edward Elgar. Elgar's wife went to Bayreuth and heard some Wagner, and she wrote in her journal, I don't see what my husband finds so amazing about Wagner, whose chief trait I deem to be its interminable length. In other words, for her, the most noteworthy thing about Wagner was duration. I think probably some of you have had that experience if you've ever gone to see a Wagner opera, especially the Ring Cycle. The last two operas of the Ring Cycle, Siegfried is over 4.5 hours, and Götterdämmerung, the Twilight of the Gods that ends the cycle, is over 5 in those performances. So I could talk a lot more about the Ring Cycle. There's a lot more to say about that, but we'll leave that once again as a desideratum for a future program. Mahler was born in 1860 and died in 1911. So he lives, really grows up and lives mostly in the Romantic era, but of course lives into the 20th century. In addition to his symphonic works, he also wrote wonderful orchestral lieder. If you remember that word from last week, lieder is the plural of the German word for song. Mahler wrote some wonderful songs, but I really want to focus on the symphonies. Again, we don't have time to listen to one, but if I might suggest, for those who are interested and want to learn more about Mahler, if you want to experience the force of the Mahler symphony, check out the finale of Mahler 2. It's the Resurrection Symphony. And once again, we see the influence of Beethoven peering even from 100 years practically removed from Mahler. Beethoven's influence manifests in the form of a chorus which sings so powerfully at the end of that symphony. Let me say a few biographical notes about Mahler, which I think will help sort of set the stage for the state of the world, more or less, as it pertained to musicians, at least, at the end of the 19th century. Mahler was living, for the most part, in Vienna. Of course, some of you know he came over to the States towards the end of his life. He spent a lot of time in Europe, in various European cities. Of course, he was primarily associated with Vienna. He himself was, nowadays we would say, Czech-born. Back then they would have said Bohemian, probably. Mahler was born in a sort of a secular, traditional Jewish family. His father was an innkeeper. He was one of about 15 kids, most of whom, I think, somewhere north of half of them died at some point before they reached adulthood. So you have to imagine, through the front door of Mahler's childhood home come travelers seeking relaxation, libation, of course, and they're clanking their tankards together in cheers and drinking, and through the back door you've got children leaving in coffins. So one thing that scholars often say about Mahler is that his life was one of great duality, and in many of his works we find that there seems to be, even in the most ebullient and triumphant works, there seems to be a dirge-like quality to at least one or two movements in those works. Mahler, I think to some degree you could say his music really reflects on or meditates upon the concept of death in general. We see that in the Second Symphony, which I mentioned is the Resurrection Symphony. Even in the First Symphony, which Mahler wrote when he was a very young man, he was in his late 20s, sometimes we call that the Twilight Symphony, although Mahler didn't call it that. Mahler takes a tune in the middle movement, and it's a tune that should sound like this. Some of you know it's Frère Jacques, or in German, Bruder Jacob. Mahler takes that same melody, which again is in a major key and sounds sort of friendly and playful, and he turns it into this. Sorry, let's take it down here because it's really in the basses and cellos where it starts. Turns it into a funeral march. There's an interesting section in that movement which sounds like it could come right out of a klezmer ensemble, and that was something that the Viennese of the late 19th century didn't appreciate so much. Remember, this is the Vienna where Karl Luger is mayor. Let me just remind you that on April 20th, 1889, in a town not so far away, a town called Braunau am Inn, there was a child born to a woman named Clara Hitler. And of course, that son was Adolf. So Mahler is living in Vienna in a time where, on the one hand, you've got all these great minds living there, right? Brahms is in Vienna, Gustav Klimt is in Vienna, Sigmund Freud is in Vienna. And on the other hand, you've got this really nasty anti-Semitism and, you might say, hyper-nationalism, which manifests in many ways for Mahler. Kind of paradoxical that he was such a champion of Wagner's works. That really was his calling card, was as an opera conductor, and yet he himself wound up, let us say Mahler, wound up converting to Catholicism for just to get a job as the opera director, because you couldn't have that job if you were Catholic and baptized. So as he's leaving the church, colleagues said, Gustav, what was it like? And he said something like, I felt like I just changed my coat. So it suggests something on the order of the superficial. Other manifestations of this meditation on death that we find in Mahler, probably you could say the end of the Fourth Symphony, which is the child's vision of heaven, sung by a soprano soloist. Maybe the most sobering example would be in a collection of songs called, ready for this in German, Kinder toten Lieder, which translates to songs on the deaths of children. That doesn't sound like it might be something you'd want to listen to, but trust me, it would be. What I want to say about Mahler in sum is that Mahler really belongs in this conservative faction. He really is someone whose music really absorbs and reflects more of the past than it does of the future. And even though he lived into the 20th century and died a year before Schoenberg premiered Pierrot Lunaire, the last piece we're going to listen to today, Mahler's music is almost always perfectly, crisply tonal. That is to say, it follows those rules that we talked about that set up those expectations that we find so satisfying, and therefore I think testifies and explains to the fact, or actually testifies to and explains the fact that Mahler remains a fixture of the concert hall. And people like listening to Mahler, people like performing it, and I think for those who have never heard a piece by Mahler, you can't go wrong with any of the symphonies. Again, I would recommend number two, especially the finale. And that's really all I'm going to say about Mahler for now, because I want to get into Debussy. Debussy's years more or less correspond to Mahler. He was born about a few years afterward, and he died in 1918. So they're more or less contemporaries. Debussy is, of course, French, and we associate him with a contemporary art movement that started in painting with another Claude. Of course, I'm talking about Monet, and the movement is called Impressionism. I'm going to bring up an Impressionist painting because it may inform our listening a little bit. That's definitely not it. Okay. Here we have actually the work that gave the name to this era, the work that Monet called Impression Sunrise. Well, we can say a lot about this painting, but let me just say one thing about Impressionism in general. Scholars often point to the fact that Impressionism was probably, to some degree, a kind of violent artistic reaction to the invention of this newfangled contraption that nowadays we all carry one in our pocket or our purse, the camera. It's really impossible, I think, to overstate the importance of the camera and how that changed the way images were conveyed. let me just tell a short story that many of you are probably familiar with. When Henry VIII agreed to marry his fourth wife, he listened to his advisor Cromwell, Lord Privy Seal, and Cromwell tells him, you should take a German wife because we need an alliance with the Protestant League. And Henry VIII, he was a lusty guy. He liked to have his wife be very pretty. So he sends his painter, Holbein, down to Germany. He says, get over to the Duke of Cleves' court and paint a portrait of his sister. And Holbein goes on his merry way to Germany. There's some evidence, there's a scholar named Alison Weir who suggests that as Holbein, the painter, was making his way out, he was sort of stopped by Cromwell, and Cromwell says, make her look pretty. The airbrusher, if you will. Okay? So Holbein goes, paints the portrait, brings it back to good old Henry VIII, sometime around just before 1540. Henry VIII sees his portrait. What does he say? Fantastic. I'll marry her. Okay, so this is the way images were conveyed back then. Of course, we know that the story doesn't end so well for Anne of Cleves. Not as badly as it might have. Anne of Cleves shows up. Henry VIII is not pleased with the way she looks in person. You might say that there's a corresponding analog between the world of online dating, right? That's not how you expected it to look. Okay, well, Henry VIII supposedly said to Cromwell, he said, I like her not, she looks like a horse. Well, Anne of Cleves was a savvy woman, and of course, when Henry VIII came to her, sent his goons over to her a couple of months after the marriage and said, we're having marriage annulled, she said, sure, no problem, whatever his grace desires. So it just, I think this story is really illuminating because it shows us just how important paintings were. And if you were a painter in 1850, what are you supposed to do with the rest of your life? All of a sudden, you've got this new device, and it takes an image and renders it perfectly in literal detail, exactly as it appeared in that moment. That's a pretty daunting prospect if you're a painter, and your parents were painters, and their parents, and so on and so forth. So what we see here in Impressionism is a move away from literal detail, right? The painting here is done with short, sort of staccato-like brush strokes, dab-like strokes, if you will. We see that the colors are almost smeared on the page, and if we, on the screen, I should say, and if we look for very specific details, what color eyes does this figure have, how big is this figure's nose or lips, we don't find that in Impressionist works. Often we find that the personal details, the face, for example, are sort of shadowed away, or not even touched upon. The emphasis is on nature. We see this, many of you who are fans of art history and fans of the Impressionist style, you'll know other names like Renoir, Manet, Degas. The style corresponds to the musical style that would emerge sometime in the 1870s or 1880s. The piece we're going to be looking at is from 1894, and this is Debussy's Prelude to the Afternoon of a Fog. If this is an Impressionist painting, and we talked about some of those features, an emphasis on light, an emphasis on nature, lack of concrete, perfectly crisp details, but rather a more fuzzy, abstract depiction, how does that correspond to music? Well, we can also programmatically have an emphasis on nature. We can have works that are about nature. We can also have, again, fuzzy details. How would that manifest in music? Well, once again, we come back to this issue of harmony, right? We talked so many times about Mozart or Beethoven. You know, when Beethoven starts a piece, if it's fast, he wants to do... Well, okay, we're in C sharp minor, or if he wants to do it slow. Etc. Well, we know what key we're in because we can hear those notes are clearly bound by a set system. But in Impressionist works, what we're going to find is that the musical language is sort of muddy, if you will. It's not as clear. Exhibit A, Debussy's Prelude to the Afternoon of the Fawn, which starts with a flute solo playing a line that sounds like this. And again, it is solo unaccompanied, so no harmony, just a single flute. Thank you. Does this suggest any key? In other words, can we sing the next note the same way we could do it with this? Where we know where the chords are moving, can we do that here? We really can't. We have these poles of C sharp and G. You don't need to know what that means, except for one little detail, which is that this interval is what we call the tritone. And for probably half a millennium at this point, music theorists have been referring to this interval as the diabolus musica, the devil's interval, the devil in music. So these are the poles of that melody. And if we have this unstable, devilish interval, obviously, we're not going to have a key that's apparent to the listener. Another thing that's kind of fuzzy about this music is that the time signature, or what we call the meter, is also completely unapparent. In other words, if I asked you to count it, how would you do it? Would you count 1, 2, 3, or 1, 2, 3, 4? We don't know. Without a score, it would be impossible. It's something that impressionist works tend to showcase, is a very abstract sense of rhythm. In other Debussy works, you might hear something called a whole tone scale, which sounds sort of like this. Like that, right? Where we have these notes. Where there's no beginning and no end, because every note is exactly equidistant from the note next to it. This is complex theory. Let me just say that this is something that in a music theory class probably wouldn't get into until theory 3 or theory 4. But we're doing the crash course version, and I hope it's not too abstract. Remember, that's the name of the game with this era, right? We're moving towards that direction. So I apologize if this seems a little bit, again, to use words I've been using all night, if this seems a little bit nebulous. It's intended that way. It's supposed to sound nebulous. When the flute starts to move, it does this a couple of times, and then it starts to climb. Hey, wait a second. That's a chord. Is this piece in E major, which is the chord I'm playing now? That's what we think it might be. Dreamlike chord, right? And this is also not a chord you're going to find in Bach. It's not a chord you'll find in Mozart. You won't even find it in Beethoven. Especially not emphasized like this. With this, I can't play it the way it's supposed to sound on a harp. And the harp, of course, has that very exotic, somewhat French sound, especially in this piece. It has that wonderful dreamlike quality to it. These are all elements of impressionism. Harmony, rhythm, a sense of directionless floating. And that can be a very wonderful thing. It's not maybe going to be as easy to sing back or hum to yourself as that Mozart sonata that you might have listened to the day before. But Debussy is moving away from that by design. In fact, often we spend a lot more time talking about this, but one thing that we often say about Debussy
is that his music is very French sounding. Well, obviously, but what does that really mean? It means that Debussy is moving away from the German sound which had dominated the continent for much of the 19th century, right? Bach, Handel, Haydn, Mozart, Beethoven, Schubert, Schumann, Mendelssohn, Brahms, Wagner. What do all these names have in common? They're German or Austrian. So let's say they're German speakers. So Debussy, when asked once about Wagner's music, he said, "What do you think of Herr Wagner?" He said, "Just because a piece is long doesn't mean it's good." And Debussy's pieces tend to be very compact. This falls into the category of a tone poem. This is the prelude to the Afternoon of the Faun. We'll listen to about 3.5 minutes of music, which will take us up to the first cadence. So there's that flute. Notice this sense of no rhythm. You can't conduct it easily, you can't count it easily. It just sort of floats there. And here we see the harp, glissando coming up. Notice the horns, now a silence, now the harp comes back. Finally, after 3.5 minutes, we get an actual resolution and the music settles into the key of E major, which is in fact the key of the piece. Let me say two more things about Debussy before we move on. Number one, he himself did not like the term impressionism applied to his music. He considered it to be, I believe his words were, that's idiotic. Debussy was an unfiltered speaker. If you want to entertain yourself, you can Google some of his more colorful quotes. However, he clarified that he was very humbled and flattered that he was being compared to Monet and to these great painters who had started this tradition. But on the other hand, he didn't like that his music was being filed under any ism, be it expressionism, which would be the next generation, or impressionism, or romanticism, or anything. He was someone who, I think, really had a fierce independent streak, and most of his music falls into this category of being, to some degree, relatively abstract, but still accessible to the listener. You might say, before we take a deep breath and jump off the cliff together, which we're going to do in about 2 minutes, you might say that Debussy is the last stop on the train that's been going since the Renaissance up until the end of the 19th century. You might call this the tonality train. And all of a sudden, that train's going to get derailed. You might say it's going to be derailed by a couple of very ambitious composers who had a new direction in mind for music. So if you like Debussy, absolutely indulge in it. It may take 3 or 5 or 8 minutes until you get a cadence, but you're going to get a cadence.
music is going to finish and it will give you that sense of satisfaction and resolution. It's not going to be like Mozart. Mozart is going to start you off and we'll give you one bar. Give you that sense of resolution within a few moments, within a few measures. Debussy is going to take a while. You may have some of these harmonies along the way, but fundamentally Debussy is a tonal composer. And so now we make this break with tonality and we jump into the era of atonality, that is to say, an era characterized by the absence of tonality. We're going to be looking at two composers in this final 25 minutes that we have together. I'm going to start with Igor Stravinsky, and I'm going to start with a work that is now 104 years old. It premiered in May of 1913, one of the most infamous premieres of any musical work. Those of you who know this story, and I'm talking about The Rite of Spring, right here spelled R-I-T-E, as in the ceremony or the tradition of spring. Stravinsky's music, where to start? First of all, we should say that he lived to be almost 90 years old. And so it's impossible to succinctly summarize the style of Stravinsky's music. He had many different phases of his life, but I think the one that tends to be studied, performed, and analyzed the most is this phase that we sometimes refer to as the phase of the great ballets, where he was collaborating with a couple of other Russian expats living in France in a group known as the Ballet Russe. The work Rite of Spring is just one of a few ballets from this period that get performed fairly often. Rite of Spring, Petrushka, Firebird, I would say would be the big three. We're only going to talk about Rite of Spring. Let's say a few things about Stravinsky's background. Number one, if you're an avant-garde composer, it makes sense that you have to leave the Soviet Union, especially after October 1917. This was not a place geographically where an avant-garde composer, someone who's entertaining ideas of music that's going to rattle a few cages and ruffle a few feathers, is going to prosper. So Stravinsky makes his way over to France, where he hooks up in Paris with a number of other Russian expats. Probably the most significant, I'm going to mention his name, was a guy named Sergei Diaghilev, and of course the famous choreographer Vaslav Nijinsky. The Rite of Spring is a ballet, and ballets have stories, so we should know what the story is. The story of The Rite of Spring is very simple. It's 40 minutes based on something that can be summarized in three sentences. It's set in a pre-Christian, so that is to say a pagan Russian setting. They're in the foothills of the Caucasus Mountains. We don't know exactly, but we know it's cold. And we know that if you were a pre-Christian pagan tribe living in the foothills of the Caucasus Mountains a long, long time ago, that spring would be an especially auspicious time of year, and one where you would make sure to thank your pagan gods for the return of warm weather that allowed you to live and till the ground and farm for that next cycle that would keep you sustained until the next winter. So what do they do to thank their gods? They have to make a sacrifice. And of course, what sacrifice could be better than a human sacrifice? That's actually the last movement of Rite of Spring, is what's called the sacrificial dance. And let me suggest, this is not something that we could just casually dance to with a few lessons. Sacrificial dance is perhaps one of the most challenging things. Certainly in 1913, I think it was probably one of the most challenging things that had ever been attempted by a dancer. Part of the reason for that is because of Stravinsky's sense of rhythm. So we talked about impressionism. I think with Stravinsky and The Rite of Spring, we might draw a parallel between another artistic movement. We might think about Cubism. And when we think of Cubism, who comes to mind? Picasso. So think of something like, oh, I always think of Les Demoiselles d'Avignon, with all of those ladies of the night who are working, I guess. And they're depicted, and it's not clear, are they standing up? Are they lying down? They're naked, but of course they're sort of covered with a sheet, and they're wearing tribal masks, some of them. So Cubism, we think of some of the features of Cubism, sharp angular lines, again, avoiding a realistic depiction in favor of one that has these harsh, jutting, geometrical aspects. We think of perspective and how perspective is often played with in a Cubist work. We're not sure, again, I mentioned, are they standing up? Are they lying down on a bed? it's not clear, and I think that's part of the attractive draw of looking at and analyzing the Cubist work. With Stravinsky, we get rhythms, and we get a dancing style, a choreographed style here. Of course, the choreography is the work of Nijinsky. We get choreography which flies in the face of everything we associate with ballet. Now, as my wife will gladly tell anyone who wants to hear, I am not a dancer. I have two left feet. I am very clumsy. All of my dexterity is concentrated right here, and not my feet. However, I can feel a beat. I can grab something that's in 4-4. I can sort of move along to a waltz and not botch it too badly. Well, when we think of dancing in general, and ballet in particular, what kind of dancing do we think of? What are some adjectives we might use to describe, say, something like Swan Lake or Nutcracker, Sleeping Beauty? Some adjectives that come to mind. Graceful, noble, elegant, light.
Dramatic.
Yes. When we have a ballet dancer, we think of them dressed in sort of form-fitting clothing that highlights the form that these ballerinas train for. Again, these words come to mind: light, elegant, very noble, graceful. Well, what does Stravinsky and Nijinsky do in this ballet? They have the ballet dancers wearing these kind of tribal cloaks, right? So the form is completely obscured. You can't see the bodies. He has them dancing, not going up on point, that is to say, use a very technical term right now, going up on their tippy toes. You don't have that rite of spring. Instead, the emphasis is on stomping and sort of arms jutting out in directions, heads snapping to and fro. This is not the kind of ballet that the audience in Paris, of all places, in 1912 was expecting on that hot evening in late May 1913. And so sometimes you'll read about the Rite of Spring, and one of the things that people often talk about is this infamous debacle of a premiere, which, A, the music was very difficult, and the performers had a hard time with it. If the performers are having a hard time, who else is having a hard time? Right? We know that there's a trickle-down effect. Musicians are not being crisp, they're not following the beat, they're not executing well, so the dancers are missing their cues. The dancers are stumbling around, so the audience isn't happy. They actually had to restart the piece. Can you imagine going to the New York Philharmonic or to the Marinsky Theater and seeing and saying, well, hold on, folks, we're going to try that one again. Ignore that. We didn't mean that. That's not the real one, but the next one counts. It seems preposterous to us, but such was the nature of a piece that was so technically demanding. Let me get into the music now. We're going to pick up right when the curtain rises. So we have this orchestral prelude, which is called The Kiss of the Earth. It's a very sort of earthy piece, right? Again, tribal, savage in a way. And the music has to sound correspondingly tribal or savage. We know that the choreography is going to fulfill that expectation. What about the music? One of the wonderful things that Stravinsky does here and when the curtain comes up is he gives us this brand new harmony to contend with. And if you were to look at the score, you might be fooled, because if you don't look at the whole thing, you might see on the bottom the strings are playing E major, or what Stravinsky writes as F flat. But then the other strings, the strings are divided into parts, so we get another string group that plays this. That's E flat 7. So let's put it together. What do we get? Gives us all sorts of dissonances. If I superimpose the chords, it sounds like this. And then he gives us this rhythm that sounds sort of like this. Demolishes any trace of romanticism is that he's turned the string section featuring those violins which form the backbone of any romantic orchestra from Beethoven right up to Mahler, and all of a sudden Stravinsky has turned those strings into a percussion section. They've essentially become the drums of the orchestra. And what are they playing? They're playing this very dissonant superimposed harmony, which creates not atonal in this case, this is what we call bitonality. So let's go ahead and watch and listen
to, again, the second movement of the Rite of Spring. And this starts right around the 3 minute mark. We see the curtain is down here. There's the bass clarinet. Here's the shimmering chord, pizzicato strings. Among whom one will be selected for that sacrificial dance. We're making our way now past the Augurs of Spring. Now, if you've never seen that, it can be a very striking experience because I think one visceral effect that the music has on us is that fundamentally we're really attracted to that rhythm to some degree because it's so erratic, because it's so unpredictable. The accents, since it's the word we use to describe it in music, the accents are all over the place and they're very difficult to anticipate. So you may find that listening to this and watching it, especially the ballet, there's something very satisfying about seeing those arms and legs kick out and jerk the way that they do, seeing the bodies flying about in a way that's very antithetical to traditional ballet. And if you were there 104 years ago in Paris, and you were expecting something in this rich tradition from the days of Jean-Baptiste Lully in the Baroque period all the way through to Tchaikovsky, and you got this instead, it's very easy to understand why there was, not exactly a riot, but let's call it a Donnybrook. There were people fighting in the aisles, there were people yelling, there were people booing and
producing. There were people who were defending and championing the work, telling the people who were booing to shut the heck up. Now, this is not the kind of behavior that we associate with the concert hall, which since the days of Beethoven had taken on the quality, the characteristics of a temple, a sanctuary. Stravinsky, might say, stirred the pot a little bit. And a lot of that has to do with music, a lot of it has to do with, again, defying all of the tropes, the expected attributes that we encounter in ballet. So it's a wonderful piece, and if you want to really treat yourself to something that's going to really tickle your brain, try counting along with the finale. It's pretty much impossible to do without a score. And then once you've done that, imagine what it would be like to try to learn the dance moves. And you've got, you know, you start with a measure of 5/16, then 3/16, then 2/8, then 1/16, then 2/4, then 3/16. Now, what I'm calling out here are time signatures, and most of these are time signatures that you're not going to encounter when you are reading typical music that people play. Again, we're moving into a new era, and we see that part of that, the repercussions or the aftermath of these innovations, is that it forces players to learn techniques which had never been explored before. So you could take the best musicians in the world in 1913, but if nothing like this has ever been written, they don't know how to do it. Stravinsky is one of the first composers to write what's called the flutter tongue technique for flute. If you've ever played flute, you might, or if you listen to Jethro Tull, you might know that you can sort of use your tongue and sort of make a trilling sound with the tongue, which is a totally different timbre. You can imagine the first flute looking at the score and thinking, what the heck does this mean? So just because you have a professional orchestra, the music is so new, nothing like this has ever been seen before. Speaking of something that had never been seen before, we're going to now move to our final work of the night. And actually, I've got it two slides back here. This is going to be a work by Arnold Schoenberg. And that's a name that can make the hair stand up on your neck. Because let's face it, most people think of Schoenberg, and they're thinking of a style which is heavily dissonant, which in many ways embodies this new sense of atonality. We're just going to listen to the end of this clip. We're looking right now at a work called Pierrot Lunaire, which translates roughly to Pierrot in the Moonlight. It's a setting of 21 poems by a Belgian named Albert Giraud, and Schoenberg himself translated these poems. They really appealed to him. I might say a lot about Schoenberg. We're going to find out more about that in a minute. And he sent them to music. So there's 21 songs. We're going to look at just one of them. The songs run the gamut in terms of what they explore. They're kind of a window into the psyche of Pierrot, who is this demented, insane clown figure, a mime in the Commedia dell'arte tradition. And so he has these crazy dreams. They're about everything from sex to politics to religion. And this one is about the latter. It's called Madonna, so of course it's going to evoke imagery related to Mary. But let me just suggest that this is not text that you would find in any gospel. This is text that, again, this is the twisted ramblings of an insane mind. This is the character of Pierrot, and Schoenberg saw these poems and said, I've got to set these to music. Schoenberg himself was born in Vienna. He moved to the States and died in 1951. Interesting details about Schoenberg. He was a very paranoid triskaidekaphobic. That is to say, he had a paralyzing fear of the number 13. He was always worried he would die at the age of 76 because the numbers at 7, 6, 13. And of course, he did. He wrote an opera which is called Moses und Aaron. He spells Aaron A-R-O-N because if you spell it with two A's, you get Moses went out 13 letters, and he was not willing to do that. In Pierrot Lunaire, he asks the singer, it's for voice and this sort of chamber ensemble, he asks the singer to utilize a technique which is called in German, Sprechstimme, which for those of us in German, well, Sprech means to speak, and Stimme means to voice, often in a vocal setting, for example, a choral voice. So what you might say is that it translates, and it's usually rendered in English as speech song or speech singing. Well, what on earth does that sound like? Well, if you were to look at the score, what you would notice is that Schoenberg, he writes notes down. In other words, he tells a singer, sing a G, sing an A flat, sing an F. But he puts little indications, little X's, that seem to suggest, sing somewhere in the neighborhood of this note, or sing in this direction. Don't worry too much about pinpointing the accuracy. Now, can you imagine if you were a singer back then, let's say a trained leader singer or a trained opera singer, what on earth would you think looking at something where the composer says, don't really worry about the notes? You know, it's like if I want to play Mozart, this great Mozart sonata in C major. Someone tell me, don't worry so much about the notes, and I say, okay, I'm sort of in the right ballpark, but it's not quite right. You see the idea of how radical this is. The song is about 2.5 minutes long. When you listen to it now, it is translated. And of course, there's lots to say about the song. We'll say a few things after we listen, and then we'll wrap up. Yes, it's okay to laugh. Said when he went over to Europe in his 20s, he was born in 1900, so he comes over to Europe and he comes back and he said, well, Aaron, what did you think about Europe? What did you learn there? And he said, I learned that they're chasing everyone out of the concert hall. Nobody wants to listen to this stuff. It's written for a bunch of smarmy academics in their ivory towers, and it's written for the people who are promoting it. again, from their pulpits or from their spots in academia. There's lots to say about this piece. Let me say a few things, because I know we're at 8 o'clock and I want to leave time for questions, which there may be quite a few, I hope. Schoenberg's music is, in this phase of his career at least, is often filed under the category of, wait for it, expressionism. So we know impressionism, we associate that with Monet and Degas, the other French impressionists, and we associate it with color and light and nature and water. I think it's fair to say that these are all things that people like. Yeah? We like color. We like nature. We like water. And so, impressionism, if you look, I don't have figures available, but it seems to me that impressionist art is maybe some of the most successful art in the history of commercial art, right? I don't know, I think Paul Cézanne's The Card Players is the most expensive painting ever sold. The Qatari family bought it, the royal Qatari family bought it for $250 million or something like that. Not bad for a painting, $250 million. But what about expressionism? What do we associate with expressionism? Well, some of you may be familiar with a very famous painting. I'll bring it up now.
It's called, in German, Die Schrei der Natur, and it's by a painter named Edvard Munch. Let's call it The Scream. And when you take a look at it, this is an expressionist work. Now, compare this once again, or let's go down actually, let's compare this to impressionism. We talked about color, we talked about light. Well, we have colors here, but they're sort of dark. The central figure here is completely androgynous, that is to say, neither male nor female. All we can tell about the central figure is that the figure is deeply disturbed, tormented, and in profound agony or anguish. Despair, loneliness, depression, isolation. These are some hallmarks of expressionist artworks. And I think it's fair to say that the music has a similar cast to it, doesn't it? The music is not meant to be pretty. It's meant to force you as the listener, as the viewer, to confront an emotional response that you're having to it, and maybe to relate to it at some level. I think there's a lot to be said for this. Let's remember that Pierrot Lunaire debuts in the summer of 1913. I think in August, actually. That means that it's 1 year before the outbreak of World War I, what they call the Great War. Of course, we know there was nothing great about it other than the level of destruction and calamity. Maybe we might say that Schoenberg's music and the expressionist movement in general was reflective of a general atmosphere, especially in Western countries and in learned places, that things were headed in a bad direction. I think it's also fair to say that these artists were interested in depicting things which had been, up until that point, pretty taboo. Munch has another painting, some of you may know it, it's called Death in the Sick Room. And I think to myself, who would want to hang this in their house or whatever like that? Can you imagine? It's exactly what it sounds like. It shows a bunch of mourners, ashen-faced, sort of, we don't see the deceased who's in the bed. We just see a bunch of people crying in a room in 19th century dress. You think, why would anyone want to paint that? Well, I think part of the impulse is this artistic desire to force an audience to confront real-life emotional experiences. And in the case of Pierrot Lunaire, there's many songs. My favorite maybe is number 8, which starts like this. Finster schwarze Riesenfalte, holden der Hundenlass. Which translates to something like, giant, gloomy, black moths obliterate the sun's radiance. So in other words, if you were, you know, raising a small child, this is exactly the kind of music you want to play in the nursery. Let me end by saying something that may surprise you, which is that music, after Schoenberg, goes perhaps in an even crazier direction. And if I had to throw out a couple of names, I might say someone like Karlheinz Stockhausen comes to mind. Stockhausen wrote a piece called The Helicopter String Quartet, where he put 4 string players in helicopters, and he just has them playing tremolos for 30 minutes. Imitating the sound of helicopter rotors. Maybe the ultimate manifestation of lunacy in music
is the music of John Cage, if you want to call it music. Some people dispute it. Cage, probably his most famous work, is 4/3, where he asks a performer to come out on stage, sit at the piano, start a stopwatch, sit there for 4 minutes and 33 seconds, stop the watch, and that's the piece. So if someone unwrapped a lozenge or someone coughed, that's the music. I think for some people, when you hear that, when you encounter Cage, all of a sudden Schoenberg becomes a little bit more attractive. Well, plenty more to say, folks, but of course our time tonight is up. I want to just say right now that hopefully we can take some questions and then we'll wrap it up. And this, by the way, questions tonight can be about anything we've covered over the course of the series, or perhaps something we haven't covered. If you really want to know about Handel's oratorios or about Wagner's Ring Cycle, really want to know about that, we can talk about that. Yes?
In the Rite of Spring, was it choreography done or first, or the music?
Music always comes first. Good, great question, by the way. In general, the music and the ballet will always come first, and then the choreographer will listen to it, usually at the piano, and then they'll start sketching out. I'm not a dancer, as I mentioned, but you have to have the music first, because then you'll know how many beats come here and there, and how many, at which point the dancer should go up, where the accent should be placed, etc. The opposite direction is true of opera. In opera, the lyrics come first, then the music shapes the lyrics. In ballet, the dance sort of fits into the music. So it's a good question, because when it comes to the ontology of music in large-scale work, sometimes it's difficult to determine, but almost always in a ballet, music comes first, then the dance. And usually it all starts with an idea. So here they started probably with this idea of this pagan sacrificial rite, which was going to take place. Yes, sir.
In the Baroque and the classical period, there were many pieces featuring the woodwinds, trio sonatas, concertos.
Yes.
And then after about 1820, an orchestral piece might have a nice woodwind solo, but I can't think of one major composer who wrote a concerto for a woodwind instrument.
Yes, concertos for woodwinds are unusual. The volume are about 20 bassoon concertos alone.
37.
He wrote about 540 concerti total, so Vivaldi was a prolific concerto writer. He wrote concertos for recorders, too, so to Telemann and other Baroque composers. When I think about great woodwind concertos, I think probably what comes to mind first and foremost is Mozart's clarinet concerto. That's 1790, 19th century. I think what happened was, to some degree, they became obsessed with size. And once the size became so big, the orchestras got so large, sound became kind of homogenized, that you got this general string sound, and that's what you get running through much of the 19th century. But you're right, Brahms, you know, Tchaikovsky, I think of their concertos, they feature violin, they feature piano. Like most composers, it's either violin or piano. When you get to Elgar and Dvorak, you get famous concerti for cello. But you're right, woodwinds are kind of missing. I think one composer who does utilize woodwinds, we talked about tonight, would be Debussy. And we heard the wonderful way he sometimes transfers lines between flute, oboe, clarinet. Another composer who comes to mind would be Ravel. I think the Impressionists in general wanted to move away from that string-heavy sound. So we do get more woodwind writing, but certainly the heyday of a composer writing 37 concertos for a low double reed instrument, the bassoon, unfortunately those concerti belong to a bygone era, and I don't see another composer writing that in that idiom for that instrument. Yes, sir.
With the silver screen, there's a moment move. Can you make a comment on that?
Yeah, that's a good question. Questions about film music?
Yeah.
Early in the days of film, you have a lot of classical composers who are writing for film. Aaron Copland is a great example. Korngold is another example, Eric Korngold. Nowadays, people tend to go to school and study film composition, so we've had a divergence. People often ask me, what kind of music do I think from today's day and age will be listened to and performed and played and analyzed and talked about 50 or 100 years from now? And often I say, probably film scores, because they are so dynamic and they are so instrumental in helping us experience film experience. I think great examples that come to mind would be something like Star Wars. Can you imagine watching Star Wars on mute with the closed captions? The experience would be fundamentally different, and I would say significantly diminished. A lot of that is thanks to John Williams, who was maybe in the late 20th century and 21st century the most prolific and successful film writer. Of course, there are others. Zimmerman comes to mind. He's another composer whose work I admire. Danny Elfman comes to mind, another successful film composer. I think in the realm of television, you've got some iconic music, which if you were to take a sample of a cross-section of society and see who knows what, which pieces, how many people would recognize the theme song to Game of Thrones or something like that? A lot of the success of that show is, I think, due to the excellent scoring. So film music is huge, and I think 50 or 100 years from now would be something that's really still being discussed, whereas the music of, say, a contemporary classical composer, something like a John Adams, might be a footnote in the textbook. So that often I always tell students, I have no idea, I don't have a crystal ball, but my sense is that film music will comprise a part of what people will remember from this era years and years from now.
The atonality of Schoenberg, you introduced that as not meeting our expectations as the prior music was, but within that definition, is there a formal structure to his music that establishes a school where...
Oh yeah, Schoenberg actually was obsessed with form and with rules. In fact, he would go on to codify one of the most rigorous styles of music in the 20th century of any era, and this is what's called, some of you may have been forced to study this if you took music theory, advanced theory. He invented and codified what was called the 12-tone system of composition. 12-tone music is something that most people who graduate with a music major and take that class still have no idea what the heck it means. Some of you are probably like, yeah, pretty much. I didn't really understand it until graduate school. 12-tone music means you pick, before you even start composing the piece, you pick what's called a tone group, which is a very particular sequence of the 12 chromatic pitches of the Western scale. And you pick it and you order it exactly in order, and each of those pitches gets a number. And so Schoenberg has pieces where that tone group is played. When you get to the 12th note, you go back to the first, but the rhythms could be different, the range could be different, the register could be different. You don't even have to present that tone row in order. You can present it in what's called retrograde order. Of course, we'll do backwards. You can present it in what's called inversion, which means that the intervals are upside down. There's a great opera, I think it's great anyway, from 1935. It's by Alban Berg, and it's called Lulu. And it is a 12-tone opera. So when Lulu comes on screen, we're on stage. We hear her tone row, which is the notes, I think it's C, E, F, D, G, A, F sharp, G sharp, B, B flat, E flat, D flat, right? And every time, you know, these you hear these notes. Now, that's a tone row that's actually kind of pretty in a way. Not all of them are like that. Some of them are very distant. So Schoenberg was obsessed with order and with rules. And in fact, he and two of his students, Alban Berg, I mentioned, and Anton Weber, who become associated with something that historians refer to as the second Viennese school. Of course, the first Viennese school was Mozart, Haydn, Beethoven. Maybe you could throw Schubert in there. This is the second Viennese school, and it's a school we associate with dissonance, atonality, and this new system called the 12-tone system. It was a big deal in the 20th century. I don't personally like much 12-tone music, but there are some pieces. The Baron Violin Concerto is 12 tones. That's also a wonderful piece. So yes, Schoenberg was associated with school, and he was associated with rules. Yeah.
Copeland, when you listen to his work, he made a great joke about it, but he internalized some of that because there's terrific dissonance in his work.
Sure.
And Leonard Bernstein in On the Waterfront. There's harshness, there's dissonance.
Absolutely. Yes, that's right, and I think that's where these composers succeeded so much. Let me be clear, any good composer worth his or her salt is going to have to manipulate dissonance. That's what makes music juicy, and that's what makes music, pushes it, it gives it these gravitational relationships. if you, you know, you could play everything very vanilla, but when you add, you know, one of these notes, I could just do this, but something like this, you know, adding that dissonant, resolving it. Yeah, so Bernstein for sure, and Copland, there's a lot of, you might say, progressive elements in Copland's music. Something that comes to mind for me is some of the rhythms in Appalachian Spring. And that's, of course, also a ballet, so that you've got dancers who have to contend with it. It's not as out there as Rite of Spring, but it's not some straightforward, completely tonal thing. There's elements of bitonality. So yes, these composers, I think that's maybe where they succeeded in attracting a fan base and cementing their legacies as composers whose music would be performed, is that it's not this exceptionally dissonant, heavy style. There is melody there, and it's beautiful. Yes, ma'am.
I was thinking, you were talking about composers who are going to survive, and I was wondering what you think about Mozart.
Yes, Mozart will be immortal. He'll outlive all of us and our grandchildren's grandchildren. Yeah, Mozart, I think there's a couple of reasons why. Number one, pedagogically, anyone who wants to study piano, Mozart is kind of one of the waypoints for anybody studying piano. So from a pedagogical perspective, he's indispensable. If you want to learn piano or teach piano, Mozart is a critical element. Number two, when you're studying any of the various styles that Mozart composed in, whether it was opera, we didn't talk about opera much in this unit, deliberately, we didn't want to open that can of worms, but opera, concerto, symphony, chamber music, solo sonata, Mozart was a dynamo in everything. And also he had this incredibly compelling personality, you know, the ultimate wunderkind, the ultimate child prodigy, this dynamo who could compose music effortlessly in his head. So I think for many reasons, Mozart's music will be immortal. And it's hard for me to imagine a world where people are not talking about Mozart in some way.
Yeah. Well, someone like Beethoven, whose music, you know, really, I would say, and I was here for the earlier talk on him, was more transcending, that it's more dramatic in many ways. You think of the famous, you know, Fifth Symphony.
Yes.
Or his Ninth, where he had a chorus at the end.
Well, first let me just start by commending you for coming tonight, because obviously tonight, not as big a draw as Beethoven, but we're here, so I commend you for that. Yeah, Beethoven, I think, will go down historically as not only this heroic figure in his own era, but someone whose music flavored and influenced music for the next 80 years or so after him. And I mentioned Mahler, too. Mahler, too, is, you don't have that piece if there's no Beethoven. I really believe that there's no Mahler if there's no Beethoven, or at least Mahler is a very different composer. So, absolutely, Beethoven's influence. He's probably the most recognized composer on the planet in terms of recognizing his melodies. There's an author named John Swafford who says that if there are 7 billion people on Earth, probably 3.5 billion would recognize the melody from the opening of this one. And when I was in China this past winter teaching at the university in Chengdu, I was amazed at these students who had no background in Western classical music, they all knew Beethoven's Ninth Symphony. And they had their own words in Mandarin that they sung to it, and they didn't even know who Beethoven was, but they knew the melody. So 3.5 billion people know your tune, that's a pretty good tune. We have time for one more.
Was there any influence of Asian music or African music? I don't hear anything.
Yeah, great question.
Art began to...
Yes, absolutely. Asian music for sure. One composer that comes to mind, actually a number of composers that come to mind, some Russian, some not Russian. Modest Mussorgsky, if you know pictures at an exhibition, starts like this. Scale. It's what we call a pentatonic scale. You can easily sort of visualize it on the piano because it's all black keys, right? Stravinsky has there's a moment probably about 2 minutes after we stop where a flute comes in on a trill just on these notes. then the wind instruments.
Is it chords or the...
It's what we call a pentatonic scale, which is a five-note scale, and it is something that you find is ubiquitous in Chinese music. When I was in China, I had a chance to talk to some musicians about it. I said, yeah, basically it's everywhere. It's the national sound. It's also true in Japan. I don't know anything about Korean music, but I would assume that it's prevalent there as well. It is a five-note scale, and you'll find it in the music of Debussy uses pentatonic scales. The French Impressionist composers, Ravel, Fauré, Durufle, you'll find pentatonic music there. So there is an Asian influence. As far as African influence, not as much. Of course, where we find African influence is in jazz. And that is a whole other series. That's one more.
Do you do other series?
Well, right now I'm focused on the fall semester, but we are certainly hoping, and I think very confident, that we will be able to arrange more programs here at the Darien Library because it's such an awesome place. I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to wrap up tonight, folks, by thanking everyone for those who have been here since July and for those who are coming. Perhaps this is your first night. Thank you so much for joining us and for spending some of your time with me and my pal, Arnold Schoenberg. Not exactly the kind of music you might have expected to listen to tonight, but I hope perhaps that you'll have maybe a new perspective on it and at least understand a little bit about where it comes from. So thank you so much, folks, and I cannot wait to see you at the next program, which will hopefully be not too distant in the future. Thanks again.